Leia here from leiaforsci.com/MCAT, and in this video, I'll show you how to tackle projectile motion questions as they show up on your MCAT. You can find my entire series on translational motion by visiting my website, leiaforsci.com/MCATphysics. On the MCAT, or physics in general, a projectile tends to refer to a rocket or catapult, something that is launched. A projectile is something that has an initial velocity somewhere between the x and y direction. So we'll call that velocity initial. And to figure out components such as height, time, distance, and so on, you have to break it up into its vector components to find vx, solving for the x direction problems, and vy to solve for y direction problems. Let's summarize before going into a problem by describing what I like to think of as the Looney Toons effect. If something is shot off at an initial velocity, but you're not given an acceleration, then the only acceleration in the problem is that in the y direction, because your velocity initial breaks down into a standard x and y velocity, but gravity is a downward acceleration that is always constant. To find the distance that a projectile traveled, you would use an x equation that does not account for acceleration, and that is x is equal to vt, the v being vx. In order to find that vx, you simply break the v initial into its x component. But to find the time, you have to refer back to the y equations. You have your initial y velocity going up, but the y acceleration, gravity, going down. So as the projectile is going up, 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 gravity slows it down to the point where it gets to that height where the velocity slows down to a zero. That means it's at the highest point that it'll be, and then changes velocity to fall straight down, going faster and faster until it hits the ground. The x and y components are completely independent of each other in this respect, and this is where the Looney Tunes idea comes in. If you've watched cartoons as a kid, think back to the Roadrunner cartoons, where the coyote is chasing the Roadrunner, and he keeps running and running right past the edge of the cliff until suddenly he looks down and realizes there's nothing under him, and he crashes straight to the ground. That's kind of what's happening. Just imagine the projectile takes off and it travels at a consistent velocity in the x direction until the time runs out and it's like coyote looks down and just crashes right there. So to find the distance, we need to find the time where the coyote essentially realizes he's in midair. That's where your time's going to end. And we find that from the y components. Now, one more thing to keep in mind is on the MCAT, you're not going to have a question like this that has you solve multiple simultaneous equations, but you may find yourself having to solve one component of projectile motion, so it's important for you to know what to do every step of the way in case that is the step you're tested on. Let's apply these concepts to this question. A baseball player hits the ball with an initial velocity of 42.1 meters per second at a 38 degree angle. How far does the ball travel? The first thing we want to do is get an idea of what's going on, and since we have an initial angle and initial velocity given, let's draw it out. The angle theta is given as 38 degrees with an initial velocity of 42.1 meters per second. We're asked how far does the ball travel, which means we're asked to solve for x. Since there is no acceleration in the x direction, we'll use the acceleration independent equation, something I explain in video 9 in this series, and that is x is equal to vt, or specifically vxt. Let's start by solving for vx. We know that we'll need vy, so let's solve for both simultaneously. We'll use the trick of vx is equal to v cos, spelled with an x, theta, and Vy is equal to V sine, spelled with a y, times theta. If you're not comfortable with this shortcut, go back to my MCAT trigonometry video, which you can find on my website at leiaforsci.com/MCATmath. The next thing to do is find the values of sine 38 and cosine 38. On my MCAT math cheat sheet, also on that page, I give you the angles to memorize for 30, 45, 60, 90, but nowhere do we have 38. And I don't want you to memorize all the different angles. Instead, I want you to figure out how you can find it. 38 is somewhere between the angles of 30 and 45. So if we can find the cosine values and sine values for 30 and 35, we'll take the middle number and use that as our estimation. Sine of 30 is 0.5, sine 45 is 0.7, cosine 30 is 0.9, cosine 45 is also 0.7. The halfway between 0.5 and 0.7 gives us sine is equal to 0.6. The halfway between 0.9 and 0.7 gives us a cosine of 0.8. Now let's do the math. V cos theta is 42 times 0.8. If this is hard to do in your head, let's try the decimal trick. We'll move one to the right and one to the left. Now we have 8 times 4, which is 32. If you want to round a little closer, you can also do 8 times 0.2. 8 times 2 is 16, which is close to 20, so 8 times 0.2 is about 2. Let's make this 34, and this is Vx. For Vy, we have 42 times 0.6. We'll do the trick again, decimal to the right, decimal to the left. 6 times 4 is 24. For 6 times 0.2, we have 6 times 2, which is 12. So 6 times 0.2 is 1.2. Let's raise this by 1, giving us 25 as our Vy initial. That's Vx initial. Going back to our initial equation, we have that x is equal to Vx of 34 meters per second, but we still need the time. In order to find the time, we have to use the y components to see how long it takes this projectile to get to the top. But remember, that's only half of the total time. You have the time it takes the ball to get to the maximum height, and then the same time for the ball to get from the maximum height down to the starting height. It gets a little more confusing when you want to solve for something like time. From your physics class, you may want to use your delta y is equal to v initial yt minus 1 over 2 gt squared. This comes from your v initial t plus a half at squared, but gravity is downward, so we changed a to g and plus to minus. We have two problems with this equation. One, we don't know about delta y. Yes, we can solve for delta y, but we were never asked for it, so we don't care about it. Even if we did solve for delta y from another equation, having velocity times t, and here t squared, that will give us a quadratic, and that is something you want to avoid at all costs on the MCAT. So looking back at your list of equations, again, something I talk about in the next video, we want to come up with the y-independent equation, the one that only has velocity, acceleration, and time. And that equation is v final is equal to v initial plus at. Given that we're dealing with a y direction, we have negative because acceleration is down, and g because we're dealing with the acceleration of gravity. Since we're solving from the moment the baseball is hit until the time it takes to reach the top, v final is equal to zero because the velocity stops before it starts to plummet. So let's go ahead and isolate t. We'll subtract v initial from both sides, giving us negative v initial is equal to negative gt. We'll cancel out the negatives, giving us positive values to work with, and then we'll divide both sides by g, giving us the new equation t is equal to v initial y over g. We got a v initial y as 25 meters per second, and gravity on the MCAT estimates to 10 meters per second squared. Let's handle the units first. Meters cancel, seconds cancels the square. We have 1 over 1 over second, which is second. 25 divided by 10 has that factor of 10 trick. We have 1 zero, that means we move the decimal back one space, which gives us time is equal to 2.5 seconds, but remember, this is only half the time, or the time it takes to get to the top. If you're not comfortable with this, let's take a look at the path of the baseball. The baseball is hit, and then it goes up and up and up until it reaches V top, which is equal to zero, and this happens to be your Y max. And then gravity takes over, giving you an increasing velocity going down until we hit the bottom. The velocity going up is the inverse of the velocity going down, because going up goes slower, slower, slower. Going down, we go faster, faster, faster. And so if we call this T1, that's time to get to the top, T2, will be time to get to the bottom, but they're equal. So all we have to do is take our time and multiply it by 2 to get to the total, since we're starting and ending at approximately the same height. So we have 2.5 times 2, which is a total of 5 seconds. Now that we have the time, we can go back to that initial equation where we have x is equal to v initial xt, and that's 34 meters per second times 5 seconds. The seconds cancel out, leaving us with meters as the answer, which is good because we're looking for a distance. 34 times 5 may not be as easy to do in your head, but 30 times 5 is 150 because 3 times 5 is 15. 4 times 5 is 20. Adding them up, we get 170 meters. Now, I realize we did a lot of rounding and estimation in this problem, but on the MCAT that's fine, because an answer that is close enough is good enough. But just to show you how close we are, I punched these numbers into the calculator and got a distance of 175 meters, which as you can see is very, very close to our answer. Be sure to check out the next video where I take you through the individual kinematic equations, showing you how they relate to the different forms you may have learned, and then I show you how to decide which equation to use for any given problem so that you don't waste time trying to go through all of them. You can find this video along with my entire series on translational motion on my website at layatfirstsight.com/mcatphysics.
Are you stuck on a specific MCAT topic? I offer private online tutoring where I focus on your needs to strengthen your individual weaknesses. Tutoring details can be found using the link below or by visiting my website, layatfirstsight.com/mcattutor. Are you overwhelmed by the sheer volume of information required for the MCAT? Are you worried that lack of a proper study plan and low MCAT score will prevent you from getting into medical school? My new ebook, The MCAT Exam Strategy, a 6-week guide to crushing the MCAT, will help you formulate a concrete study plan by helping you figure out where you stand now, identify your goals, and figure out what it takes to reach them. And it's yours free when you sign up for my email newsletter at mcatexamstrategy.com. By signing up for my email newsletter, you'll also be the first to know when I have new videos, MCAT study guides, cheat sheets, tips, and so much more. The link again, mcatexamstrategy.com.